Hi everybody, this is Scott for Lost Souls, and today I'm going to make this little video. Hopefully it'll be a little video, because I am a preacher, and sometimes I can't ramble and go on. You know, I'm about to close. Nah, not really. But, you know, today I'm making this video about judgment. You know, the world has said, you know, the media, or the left media, has basically conned the American public and the world into believing that Christians should not judge. Now, and it also has also influenced some what I call unlearned Christians, or just, you know, babes in Christ, or Christians that just basically never looked into. When, you know, my personal belief is, if you're a Christian and you hear something in the media or you hear something in public that relates to your faith or your Christianity, it should pop up a question mark at the very least. And when that question mark comes up, it should prompt you to either investigate through studying the scriptures, or ask a pastor or elder in the church or somebody more knowledgeable about scripture than you are. And unfortunately, apparently, a lot of Christians haven't challenged this notion that thou shalt not judge. It's incorrect. It's incorrect biblical standpoint. You know, Jesus did say in Matthew 7 that thou shalt not judge. The same measure that you meet to judge, thou shalt be judged also. But what a lot of people don't know is that, you know, English, I tell people English is a black and white language. In other words, when I say love, I can say, hey, I love my guns. You know, I love guns. Everybody, you see my channel, I love my guns. But is it the same love that I have for my wife? Is it the same love that I have for my sister, my mother, my brother, my nieces, my nephews? Absolutely not. And that's one example of how the English language is black and white. That 38 looks good up there, don't it? I love it. But you know, in Greek, you know, when you say love, there may be three different forms of love. There's phileo, which is a fleshly love, like I love the way this woman looks. Or then there's agape love, where there's a godly love, a brother and sister love, you know, an incorruptible love. So in other words, when you see that word judgment in Matthew chapter 7 and a few other chapters that are actually repeated in the synoptic gospels, that word is actually krino, which is Greek for condemnation, which is damnation. In other words, you're not allowed to set judgment upon the person. You're going to hell. You know, those people, there are some Christians that go around, I guess, like Westboro Baptist Church or whatever people say they're doing is, I don't know exactly what they do, but they go around and say, hey, look, you're going to hell. You know, that's not a judgment that I am allowed, or I'm allowed to, or reserved to actually use on any person. Judgment is reserved for Jesus Christ, God the Father, on the white throne of judgment on that great and awesome day. Now, the Bible does say that the saints will judge the world and angels alongside of Christ, but that's not until that appointed day. So, in the meantime, I'm not allowed to judge anybody, whether they're homosexual, or whether they're a bank robber or a thief, you know. I'm not allowed to do that. Okay? But what people fail to realize is that in Corinthians, when Paul talks about, you know, you judge the, you're allowed to judge matters between one another, that word is criterion, you know, and that word criterion means to put a judgment. It's like, you know, Jesus talked about judgment all the time. He talked about, you know, a tree by its fruit, whether it's bitter or sweet. So that's the type of judgment we can do. So in other words, when somebody does something that, you know, exemplifies what their character or their inside is, we are allowed to make assessments on that. And that's what judges and courts do every day. And that's what we do on an everyday basis. Because if we didn't do it on an everyday basis, we basically would be robbed. We would be, you know, we would eat something and it would rot our stomach, you know. And then Jesus actually talked about either a well can put forth bitter or sweet water. And that's it. The well can only give forth bitter or sweet. You know, it's just like the tongue. The tongue gives out life or death. You know, he's talking about things that come out of you. And that's why the Bible, when you study it, you really have to have the Holy Spirit to help you, ask you to interpret. The Bible also says that the worldly people of this world cannot understand the things of God because they're not of God. You know, you need the Holy Spirit. You know, so all this, you know, thou shalt not judge, you know, when somebody does something, oh, well, just because you don't do it doesn't mean it's evil. You know, these moral revisionists, they're trying to revise moral standards throughout society. Why? Because the Bible says that they love darkness more than they do life because their deeds are wicked. You know, in other words, a lot of these people that want to change the morals of society, they're actually people that are trying to change, you know, bring it through homosexuality. They're trying to bring in same-sex marriage. They're trying to bring in three marriages, you know, people, you know, polygamy. You know, they're trying to bring in everything under the sun that's sexually immoral. You know, every movie that you see nowadays, you know, I really don't look at TV anymore because, you know, they got shows like The New Normal, which is about two homosexuals raising a child that they couldn't possibly produce themselves, you know, between one another, you know, because it's unnatural union. Then you have other shows that basically they bring cursing is the new normal on television. That is the new one of the new normals, you know. And then we wonder why our children, you know, in public curse us out or they treat us bad, you know, because they had no respect for us, you know, because we're teaching them, hey, cursing is a grown folk thing, you know, we curse every day, all that kind of stuff, you know. On TV, you see all kinds of frontal nudity and all kinds of nudity on television all the time, you know. I don't even watch television that much anymore. I just watch documentaries, the news, and that's it. I buy my movies, I Netflix it, or watch YouTube or something like that, because I can control the content. It's getting that bad. You know, every movie that I buy, you know, it's always got a... Why is it that every movie I buy has, one, a sex scene, two, a strip bar scene, three, some homosexual reference, and then four, the worst, they always have something defaming God, some type of profanity, they curse God, they blaspheme God, you know, blaspheme the name of Jesus Christ, Mary, the Father, the Catholic Church, or whatever church is there, they profaned it. You know, I watched 21 Jump Street. They had the movie. They had the police station was in the church, and the church, just like it was in the TV show. And they're cursing in front of the Jesus. They had a Korean Jesus on the wall, and they're cursing, saying profane things in front of the cross. You know, it's because, why? Because there are people in the media that are trying to control and form your opinion and subliminally just influence you. The more you watch that stuff, it just makes you harder to it. At first, when, you know, there was a lot of cursing on TV like that, you know, wasn't that much cursing on TV, somebody said something like butt, you know, and people were like, oh, don't say butt, because it was, people were sensitive to it. But over time, what happens is, when they produce more and more things like that, you become numb to it. It's just like when I was in college, I remember my brother is a Phi Beta Sigma, I have families, Omega Psi Phi, all those different kind of black fraternities. And what they do is they brand one another. But before they brand you, what they do is, one, they get you drunk. And then two, if you're going to get a brand on your shoulder, they'll slap your shoulder for a few hours. Why? To numb the area that they're going to brand. Because when they brand you, they hit it for a hot second. That's it. But because you're drunk and your area is numb, you don't feel anything. And that's what happens with sin. All kinds of sin. Not just what's happening in our society as far as the promotion of homosexuality and the revisionist, the revision of sin. It's just they're just trying to make us numb to all this wickedness. You know, every movie I've seen is nakedness. And, you know, and then why is it, you know, I used to bounce clubs and stuff like that. You know, I used to bounce clubs. I used to be in all kinds of hip-hop clubs, strip clubs. You even drove strippers to the strip club back in the day, Fox Valley up in Philly. You know what I'm saying? And why is it that back in the day, all the strip clubs used to be real small, but now they're sizes of warehouses. I mean, in Philadelphia, there's got to be 3 or 4 warehouse-sized strip clubs. Why? Because the moral fabric of America is disintegrating like a cloth out in the wet and in the sun. It's just drying up and it's withering away. You know, it's society, we have to wake up. We cannot allow our society to keep going in this direction. I don't care what the president says. Homosexuality is not a civil right. It's not. You know, they compare that with being a black man. I'm black. When I walk out my front door, I can't change that. You know, you're homosexual. What you do in your bedroom is what you do in your bedroom. I don't go to work telling people what I do with my wife in the bedroom. You know what I'm saying? It's just like, you know, I mean, yo, it makes no sense. I'm black. I had no choice. I can't change that when I leave the house. If you're a homosexual, what you do in your bedroom is your business. You know, just because you want to walk out of the house flaming and switching and dipping, don't have nothing to do with me being black. You were never hosed by the police. You were never beat down. You don't get profiled by getting pulled over by the police. You know, you don't go through any of that. You know, you don't have to check on the job application while you're black, white, or anything like that. But I do. You'll never, your struggle is not my struggle. You know, I don't care what the NAACP says, that Al Sharpton, I don't care what Jesse Jackson says. Homosexuality is not tantamount to being black. It's not equal. It's not on the same plane. And if Martin Luther King was alive, I'm quite sure he would feel the same way. You know why? Because what happened was, with all the black leaders that were really strong in the faith, the people that were against what they were doing killed them all off. And they left the weak ones like Jesse Jackson and Al Sharpton alone, because they had no message. All they had was this silliness, and nobody really listens to them. But people like Martin Luther King, they moved the masses, and that's why they were killed, you know? And so what I want everybody to do is just start praying for America. We have to continue to pray for Barack Obama, because we're mandated by Scripture. You know, pray that he hears God, either God, he hears God, or that God sends some dreams and visions and signs and wonders to change the course that he's taking this country in. You know, that's our responsibility as Christians. For all you atheists, you know, you're offended by everything I say, everything I do. What I encourage you to do is either just, you know, accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, or just continue in the direction that you're going and go, hell is a mythical place. You know, it's not real and all that stuff. Listen, you know, I've been a Christian long enough. I've been a preacher long enough to know. I even went to seminary, Liberty University. You know what I'm saying? I've known long enough about God, and I studied long enough. You don't know nothing about, you know, this one guy, Yankee Marshall. You know, he actually blocked my comments because I feel as though what I was saying to him when he was saying about God and faith, you know, that it was offensive to him. It was offensive to him because he's an atheist. He doesn't believe in anything. You know what I'm saying? But why block my comments when, you know, what I was saying was true? I wasn't berating them. I didn't hit up in the scripture. And people know me that if you get into some type of discussion with me with faith and other people's faith and religion, I done study most of them. You know, I know that's my thing. You know, I worked in a prison. And in prison, people read all day. And they read all about all these different faiths and all that kind of stuff. And I'm telling you now, I'm pretty good at what I do, you know. So for you atheists, stop being offended about God, because Christianity is going nowhere. You know, whether you like it or not, it's going to be a part of this country. Because until we get raptured, we're going to fight every second of the day to keep Jesus Christ in public eye and in every aspect of our life. It's all over. Like, I was trying to leave a post on this thing till he blocked me. He said, well, you're trying to use my web channel as a pulpit. I didn't post one scripture or anything. I'm like, what's wrong with this dude? You know, but it's all about control. I know what it is. But anyway, you know, there's so many churches that are feeding the jobless every day. There's so many Catholic churches that have hospitals, Presbyterian, all these Christian hospitals, so many you cannot even number, that are giving free hospital care. They started out doing that. You cannot account anything to the atheists. Atheists have done nothing for this country. As a mass, as a whole, as a collective, as a group, they've done nothing but tear it down. Wake up, America. God bless America. No, I'm not going to say God bless. It's like we're ordering God to bless America. Lord God, Father in heaven, please bless America. Help us. In Jesus' name, amen.